Well, thank you, Kendra. We appreciate the music here this morning. If you need a Bible to follow along with Dr. Bookman this morning, please slip your hand up and the gentleman coming down the aisles will make sure that you receive one. Want to just mention, as Steve mentioned, there are 12 signups in the foyer. One of them's mine, so by all means, if you're free tomorrow night and you'd like to come, we have a men's dinner tomorrow night. We've had these fellowship dinners in the past, and I think the last one we had about 65 people for. It was an awesome night, and so we ordered 65 people's worth of food, and we have 25 signed up. So I need 40 of you to sign up, or else my wife and I are going to be eating turkey and roast beef, and please sign up. I will be talking about the upcoming trip that I have going to China to teach. I'll be asking for your prayer and being able to just disclose what is going on there with that. So looking for that tomorrow night. So 6:30 tomorrow evening. The cost is $10. Sign up if you get a chance there on your way out. Well, it's been a real blessing to have Dr. Bookman here with us. It really has. He's a professor down at Shepherd Seminary. You may recall Dr. Dave Burgraff, who was here last year for our conference. He is there as well. And the pastors here have gone down there to pastors' conferences the last 3 or 4 years. So we've enjoyed the teaching and the ministry of Shepherd Seminary, and it's just been a real blessing to do these spring Bible conferences. What we're trying to do with these spring Bible conferences is obviously increase your knowledge of God's Word. Certainly that's an important aspect. But also, it's to whet your appetite for the Word of God, so that you get excited about it. It is so rich and it's so deep, and the excitement that Dr. Bookman has brought has just really been a blessing to us. It really has. And it's encouraged us as we've left this place to go home and pour our mind and heart towards the Gospels to explore further the ministry of Jesus Christ. And so hopefully that has been the reaction that you've had as you've been able to study under Dr. Bookman these last couple of days. And so he's going to come at this time and kind of wrap things up, I guess, as we've been going through all of these 8 days. It's been a real blessing. But Doug's a blessing, and thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you so much, and I want to take a twofold liberty here just quickly before I start. First of all, I do bring you a greeting from Shepherd Seminary, and it's a Bible-believing seminary that is very, very close mission match to the church here, and so if you're at all interested in a seminary, you know anybody, I'd love to talk to them. I am in charge of recruiting, and I never leave trolling mode, if you know what I'm saying, so... the other point to make, and I mentioned this earlier, but there we have a program called the West Institute, and it is unique, and I use the word carefully. There's nothing like it in the world. It is a one calendar year. You go in September and you're done the next August, and you get a fully accredited 42-unit rigorous Master in Theological Studies. And you got to kind of check out a life to be sure. It's in Laramie, Wyoming. And but it's just a wonderful church there in Laramie and Laramie Valley Chapel. Paul Martin is the pastor. Clayton Schultz oversees the program, the West Institute. But what is most, I think, important and dramatic about it is the discipleship dynamic. It is just amazing the impact that it has. And we designed it primarily, not exclusively, but primarily for either non-vocational ministry. That is, we pitch it this way. We go to secular colleges and we say, now look, you know, the Christian students on the campus, and say, look, you've given 4 years to prepare yourself for whatever profession you're headed for, and amen, that's what you ought to do, but you're a Christian first of all. And why not take 1 year, get a fully accredited master's, and equip yourself to minister throughout your life, wherever you are, in ways that you really would transcend what you could do without it. And so it's just it's a marvelous program. We also really, we've designed it for, and this is important, for second career ministry. For couples who are maybe getting to the place where they're getting close to retirement, they still have couple of decades of health and strength, and they got remarkable maturity and training and so on, and to take a year and to train to minister. And so I just encourage you, the West Institute, it really is one of the most dramatic ministry's ever been involved with. All right, well, and I want to say too, and Kevin didn't ask me to say this, but the ministry to which on which your pastor is embarking here in a few weeks with China Vision is a really remarkable ministry. And I'm so thrilled that he's going. The man who runs it is a man named Rob Clark, and he has just crafted such a, he's wise as a serpent. He really is. Ministering in China to both the underground and the not quite so underground church is a hugely difficult assignment, but he has done it so effectively, and there are so many locals who are being trained to minister as only they can minister in there in China. And Pastor Kevin is going to be a part of that. And I'll just say this, that it what the assignment he has accepted is remarkably demanding, just physically demanding, because it's quite underground, and you're in one building for a couple of weeks. You're not supposed to come out even. You lived your, and you're just, it's a very, very demanding. So I would just encourage you, bear him up in prayer. It's going to be an important time to always bear your pastor up in prayer. But I think especially in the next while he's there in China. Well, listen, it's been a delight to be with you, and I mean that. It's just been such a thrill to be with you, and I love the Cassidy, so it's so much fun to get to be with them for a time. But we have been going through the Passion Week. And I'm going to take just a few minutes here quickly to sort of review or overview the week. We've been going through it, and as I say, it's an eight-day week. It begins on Sunday, but it ends on the following Sunday when a tomb is discovered empty. And if it weren't for that eighth day, we wouldn't be here this morning. There'd be nothing to celebrate, but it was. And that's where we're headed, obviously, and you're going to be focusing on that in the days to come because it's the season of the year. But let me just rehearse the week. Sunday, the first Sunday, triumphal entry, I like to think of as a day of messianic presentation. It didn't happen accidentally. Jesus, because he was, in fact, as wise as a serpent, Matthew 10:16, he and harmless as a dove, as he says there, but he very carefully contrived to alert the city of Jerusalem, a city swollen to several times its normal size because of the Passover celebration, a city that was focused on the hope of redemption from Rome at that season of the year because they're remembering the Exodus, redemption from Egypt, and a city which Jesus had set on his ear, a city abuzz with excitement about Jesus personally because of the raising of Lazarus, John 11:55-56. Jesus alerted the city to his coming, and on Sunday morning he rode in. And I like to call it a day of messianic presentation because that first Sunday that we'll celebrate next week, but that first Sunday, Palm Sunday, was in fact the most important and dramatic and deliberate moment of official presentation of Jesus to that generation as Messiah. There are three lines of Old Testament prophecy which come together on that day, and it was very deliberate. And it was dramatic as the whole city erupted in happy welcome and sang the hosannas and the blessed be the name and threw down their garments and so on, waved the palm branches, all in happy welcome of a king. Now we ask the question very quickly, given Sunday, why Friday? Given the fact that on Sunday they accepted him as king, why on Friday are they crying for his crucifixion? And I like to say that the answer to that question is Monday and Tuesday, which I like to refer to as days of messianic proclamation, because without getting into it, just let me say that on those 2 days when Jesus cleansed the temple and then took possession of the temple and put his enemies to silence and open debate and then put the most careful and deliberate distance between himself and the Pharisees, I like to call those days of messianic proclamation, because on Sunday he had ridden into the city, and for all the world it seemed that that city was willing to accept him as king. But Jesus understood the true character of their hearts. And so he put them to the test. And basically, what he said on Monday and Tuesday, what he proclaimed was, I like to say, that you don't take Jesus on your terms. You take him on his terms. And they were happy to have him as their deliverer from Rome because they were sick of Rome. And Rome was a heavy taskmaster. And they had promises that Messiah was going to deliver him from Rome. And above all things, they were happy to take him as Savior from Rome, deliverer from Rome, because they knew they had no wherewithal to themselves from Rome. On the other hand, Jesus insisted that they accept him in all that the Bible teaches concerning the coming Messiah, and it begins in Genesis 3 with the seed of woman, and it is at its heart, at its most seminal basis, it is the hope of salvation from sin. But that generation was convinced that they could take care of that, thank you, themselves, because they had the law, and they accepted what the Pharisees taught them, that the way to get into the kingdom is to keep the law. And God had come, Jesus had come to challenge that face on. And so on Monday and Tuesday, Jesus drove that city to a decision. Now, they're going to announce that decision on Friday morning. But now on Tuesday evening, Judas sneaked off to the home of Caiaphas, south of the city, and made a bargain to betray Jesus to them, to help them arrest Jesus in the absence of the multitude. Jesus was so clever, he never let himself be in the absence of the multitude, and the multitude, for all the world could see, seemed entirely supportive of him. And Jesus' enemies, both Roman and Jewish, were convinced that if they just tried to arrest him, there'd be a riot. If there was a riot, the Romans were going to have to send troops and their heads were going to roll. And so Jesus was so clever, but Judas went and said, I'll help you arrest him in the absence of the multitude. Luke 22, verse 6. And that meant Thursday night at the Passover. So now there's a great deal of preparation made between Tuesday and Thursday, but on Thursday afternoon, and we said that Thursday I like to think of as a day of messianic preparation on two counts. First of all, on Thursday afternoon, Jesus leads the 12 to a place where he has arranged high on the western hill in Jerusalem in a very, very wealthy home with a huge upper room furnished for a feast. And he takes the 12 there, and having kept the place very carefully secret from Judas. But now they gather and they keep the Passover. At the end of the Passover, Jesus announces that the betrayer is at the table. In time, Judas, when he's handed the sop, gets up and he leaves to go fetch the Sanhedrinists. Again, there are the 70 Sanhedrinists and the 600 soldiers in a Roman cohort, John 18, verse 5, and Pilate with his judicial apparatus ready for a trial in the middle of the night because, and I made much of this yesterday, but I'll just say it, the whole plot that was hatched on Tuesday night, Matthew 26, Mark 14, Luke 22, it's explicit. The plot that was hatched on Tuesday night was all about getting Jesus arrested, tried, sentenced, and on his way to execution before the city woke up. Because Jesus' enemies, both Roman and Jewish, I like to say, had Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday ringing in their ears. And they were convinced that this city was going to riot on behalf of Jesus so they had to get it done under cover of night. So Judas goes off late on Thursday, leaves the upper room, goes to fetch the Sanhedrinists. Jesus introduces the Lord's Supper, and then he begins to teach. And Thursday is a day of messianic preparation, first of all, in that Jesus does, in fact, teach his apostles. In the upper room with John 14, and then 15 and 16 along the way, and then the prayer of John 17. So the point is that it's a time of messianic preparation. But then Jesus leads them out. And by the way, I should say that what happened clearly is that Judas went to the north end of town, to the fortress Antonia, where the soldiers would be, to fetch them. But he would have brought them back to the western hill, to that upper room. Finds it empty. John says, 18 verse 2, that Judas knew Gethsemane well because the disciples often stayed there with Jesus. So now Judas says, don't worry, guys, I know where he is. So he follows that same path that Jesus had taken. Meanwhile, Jesus has those moments in the garden. And so I think the Thursday is a day, first of all, of preparation in the upper room and along the way as Jesus prepares his disciples for what's about to happen. But then so importantly and so graphically, Thursday is a day of messianic preparation as Jesus prepares his own soul spirit there in the garden. And three times pours his heart out and says, Father, if there be any way, let this cup pass from me. But every time he goes on to say, not my will, but thine be done. And as he leaves the garden, he says to Peter, shall I not drink the cup which my Father has given me? And you know what, folks? You could live 1,000 lives. You'll never know the measure of temptation that Jesus knew to turn back from the cross. And understand this. It's a palpable reality on the pages of Scripture, but it's altogether too much overlooked. And that is that during his life on earth, Jesus had no more spiritual resources than you and I have. He was every bit as dependent upon the ministry of the Spirit, upon the instruction of the Word, and upon prayer. And those moments in the garden were so important to Jesus to steel himself, to prepare himself, to gird himself with the confidence of the Father's will before he went to the most awful experience we could ever imagine. Matter of fact, we can't imagine, but as close as we can get. But at any rate, so Jesus prepares himself in the garden. Meanwhile, Judas is behind him a few steps now as Jesus, with angelic help, Luke 22. With angelic help, Jesus, you know, when he entered the garden, he said to his disciples, "Pray for me, my soul is heavy in me unto death." As he contemplated what he was about to endure, it absolutely cripplingly terrified him. Not the physical demands and the horror of the cross, as awful as that is, but the reality that he was to be made sin for you and me. But now with angelic help, having prayed, having submitted himself to the will of the Father, having confessed to Peter that he was going to drink the cup that the Father had given him, and now with angelic help, he staggers out of the garden, and here comes Judas and the Sanhedrinist, and Jesus is arrested. He is, first of all, taken back up on the western hill to the priestly villa of Caiaphas, and there the Jewish leaders extract from Jesus the confession that he is Messiah King. You see, the whole point of this plot is to take Jesus to the Roman authorities. The Jewish authorities might have thought, well, we'll just go off and stone him, but they couldn't do that because Jesus was so wildly popular and there'll be a riot. It says again and again, they wanted to take him, but they couldn't because they feared the people. On that night, Tuesday night, when Judas went off to make that deal, both Matthew and Mark say that the Sanhedrinists, the leaders, threw their hands in the air and they said, "We need to kill him, but not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people." So now Judas helps them arrest him and they want to get him, but the point is they can't simply haul him off and do to him what they did to Stephen. See, the point is, because a lot of people stumble over this, by the way, if the Bible says that explicitly, John 18, that the Jews were not allowed to put people to death, that the Romans allowed them a great deal of self-rule and they could sit in judgment on somebody, but they couldn't kill them, they couldn't execute them. Well, what about Stephen? I'll bet you he wished they'd have remembered that protocol a little more carefully, right? Well, the fact of the matter is that Stephen was nobody. And the Pilate was all about just keeping a lid on things. And if they wanted to haul some nobody off behind the house, thought, okay, fine, we'll look the other way. Jesus was so wildly popular. On Sunday, he rode into the city, and the whole city welcomed him as king. So they think, we can't just haul him off. So what do we got to do? We got to get the Romans to do our dirty work. And how are we going to convince them to do that? We have to convince Rome that Jesus is a seditionist, a rebel, a revolutionary, a threat to Rome. Rome won't tolerate that, folks. And the fact of the matter is, it seems on the face of it that shouldn't be a difficult case to make because Jesus has been going up down the countryside for 3 years claiming exactly that, to be the Messiah King of Israel. But he'd done it with such circumspection that it was very, very difficult. You remember that the Jewish authorities, as they arrested Jesus or had the Romans arrest him, then brought him up there, and in the middle of the night, against all sorts of protocols basic to their own system of jurisprudence, which come from the Old Testament, by the way, they struggled to get Jesus to confess. Well, they're not to get, but find somebody who could witness to the fact that Jesus had claimed to be king, and they couldn't find anybody. And so finally, Caiaphas simply said to Jesus, "Tell us plainly, are you the Christ, the Son of the living God?" And Jesus, I think, to Caiaphas' delight and surprise, Jesus said, "I am." And that quick, the Sanhedrin, okay, we got him. We just heard him say he's a king. Rome has no room for pretender kings. This is Passover. They're horribly paranoid about that at this season. So now we can take him to Pilate. So about 4:30 in the morning, they take Jesus to Pilate, and you have a remarkable scene that we contemplated yesterday morning. And Pilate is determined not to crucify Jesus, and he makes heroic attempts to avoid crucifying Jesus. But for reasons that I think unfold for us as we consider Jesus' good confession that we talked about yesterday morning, for reasons that I think unfold in the gospel story, finally, Pilate does in fact turn Jesus over to be crucified. And it's about 6 o'clock in the morning, John 19 and verse 14. Jesus by now has been horribly misused and scourged, but now he's turned over to be crucified about 6 o'clock in the morning. And so I like to think of Friday as a day of messianic perfection, because what's about to be accomplished. But I want to trace, by 9 o'clock in the morning, Jesus is taken to a place of execution, a standard set place of execution outside a northern gate of Jerusalem, on the northwest side of Jerusalem, and a place called Golgotha, the place of the skull, for whatever set of reasons. But there Jesus is affixed to a cross by about 9 o'clock in the morning. He's going to hang there for 6 hours. For the first 3 hours, the sky will remain naturally light. At noon, God in heaven will draw a curtain of grayness, I like to call it. It's not pitch dark. God wants us to see. It's imperative. It's bottomlessly, infinitely important that we witness what's going on that hill. But it is such a miscarriage of justice. It is such a high-handed violation of all that is right and moral and just that God mysteriously pulls a supernatural curtain of grayness across the scene and over the whole earth. This is remembered in various parts of the earth at this time. And for those hours, Jesus hangs on the cross. He is silent, absent his moaning. And for 3 hours, those 3 hours, I believe, Jesus knows what it is to be forsaken by the Father. And to trace those, I think it's helpful to trace the sayings on the cross. So that's what we're going to do for the next few minutes. You know, and you'll contemplate these again as the season unfolds here, but you know that there are generally remembered 7 sayings on the cross. I said last hour that it seems to me that one of those kind of is different. I mean, it's kind of a, remember the Sesame Street, which one of these is not like the other exercise? You know, don't you feel like that's going on with the 7 sayings? There's these 7 profound sayings. You got the, I thirst. Well, I think there were 6, and I'll tell you why in just a minute. But let me say this, and I was going to take it through the scriptures, but I've got a lot to say, so trust me just a little bit. I'm going to just cite them, and I think you'll be familiar with them. But I will say this, that no one, remember now, each of the 4 gospelists is deliberately selective, and so you have to harmonize the gospels in order to come to a full story. And none of no one of the gospels tells all of these things, but you put them together, and it quite clearly what happens is, shortly after Jesus is nailed to the cross and hoisted up, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I kind of got lost in this last hour. I don't want to do it again. But I will say this, that statement has always been a bit hard for me, because I think there are clear indications in the scriptures that in a real sense, to a real degree, they did know what they were doing. Certainly the Jewish authorities did. And I get that primarily, I think, from that remarkable and stunning parable that Jesus told in Matthew 21 about the man who had a vineyard and let it out to husbandmen. And when it came time for the owner to collect his fruit, he sent servants, and they beat the servants. You remember this? And then he sent more and even more important servants, and they beat those servants and killed some of them. But then, and this is where the parable becomes a little bit unusual, because usually parables are kind of a slice out of life, but what owner would do this? Because it says at the last he sent his son, his only son, his well-beloved son. And the husbandman, and he said, surely they will respect, they'll reverence him. Now what happened? Do you remember what happened? When the wicked husbandman saw the son, here's what they didn't say. They didn't say, this guy claims to be the son, but we don't believe him. They said, this is the heir. Let us kill him and seize the vineyard for ourselves. Remember that? Now that sounds like, and I can't help, my mind goes from there to Caiaphas, the wicked high priest, who after John, in John 11, who after Lazarus had been raised from the dead, and John, the apostle, is careful to say that some of the Jewish leadership who had come that day, when they saw Lazarus come hopping alive out of that tomb amidst the smell of death, they realized this is the real thing, and they believe. But others went and told Caiaphas, And when Caiaphas heard about the raising of Lazarus and about all the excitement, this is what he said. He said, what are we going to do because this man does many signs? Now, I like to say that there's a biblical answer to that question. It's two steps. Number one, you go to the Old Testament, to the Hebrew Scriptures, and you see if there's anything about the what he's teaching that is wrong. But if he's consistent with what God already said, you know what you do? You bow the knee, for heaven's sakes. Now, this is what Lazarus said. What are we going to do? This man does many signs. If we don't put him to death, the Romans will come and take away our place and our nation. Sounds like this is the heir. Let us kill him and seize the inheritance. See what I'm saying? So I'm saying to myself, on the one hand, and I think it's important to understand, folks, and I could get lost in this. There's a lot of theological cross currents here. But I think it's important to understand that Jesus did not insufficiently make the case for who he was. And yet, on the cross, he says, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And for a while, I tried to explain that by saying that, well, he was just talking about the Roman soldiers. They were innocent. They didn't know. But that's not so, because in Acts 3, Acts 2, Peter says explicitly that out of ignorance, you and your leaders crucified Jesus. And in 1 Corinthians 3, Paul says that, I know if you had known, you wouldn't have done it. So there was some sense. Jesus says, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now let me tell you where I've come. I'm just, here you are, taking you by the hand and walking you through my spiritual pilgrimage. For heaven's sakes, who cares? I know. But this is where I've come. I think that what Jesus is thinking of primarily is the almost unimaginable difficulty of bowing the knee to Jesus' claim to be God come in the flesh. I think it is so hard for us to understand how bottomlessly, like I said yesterday, that we've got a couple of thousand years to get used to this, and it just kind of rolls off our tongue. Jesus is God, man. But the idea of God becoming man is so bottomless. And I said last hour, for my money, for a man, a human being, to claim to be Yahweh God is, on the face of it, blasphemy. It's blasphemy worthy of death by Mosaic standards, unless it just happens to be the truth. And never before in human history had it been the truth. And what is it that most importantly convinces you and me that Jesus' claim to be God come in the flesh was true? It's the resurrection. Well, these people didn't have the resurrection. See the point? They just had a man standing before them claiming to be God come in the truth. Now, I don't want to just leave it there, because God did take remarkable steps, prophecy and miracles, to make Jesus' claims not only credible but compelling. But I think when Jesus cries out, Father, forgive them, and I think this is what's behind Saul of Tarsus, who, having become Paul the Apostle, but he testifies, thinking of his reign of persecution in Acts 8, he says, I verily thought within myself I ought to do these things against Jesus. Why? Because Paul knew that Jesus had gone about healing people and doing good, but he claimed to be God. And I think it's so absent the resurrection, especially before the resurrection, can you imagine? So I leave it alone. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And then there is a thief next to him. This is in Luke, and that thief turns to Jesus. There are two, you remember, but this thief comes, God brings him to the end of himself, and he realizes that Jesus' claims are true. And that thief prayed a remarkably Old Testament prayer. He said, Master, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Because you see, in the Old Testament, from the very beginning, Job, for instance, very, very early, God helped them to understand that there was going to be a king, that Messiah was going to rule over that kingdom, and that righteous men and women would be resurrected to that kingdom. So there is hope of resurrection and kingdom, but the grave was entirely darksome. It was entirely mysterious. It was fearsome. They had no good thing to say about the grave. We know that to be absent of the body is to be present with the Lord. That's entirely New Testament. That's Paul, for heaven's sakes. That's because Jesus went and conquered the grave. But to the Old Testament saint, it was, and so he prays an Old Testament prayer. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus says, no, I can do better than that today. I think this is the first man in human history to die with the biblical God-given confidence. He's going immediately to a place of paradise. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. That's a significant step in progressive revelation right there. And then, of course, this is all while the light is still shining, the sun is still shining full, and so on. Now Jesus looks down from the cross, and he sees his mother. Now listen, let me just talk for a moment. But, you know, one of the dynamics of Jesus' life that is almost universally underappreciated, and I think is so precious, is his relationship to his physical family. And you need to understand, I think it's only implicit, but I think it's so palpably implicit that it can't be missed, that somewhere after Luke 2, after Jesus experienced the age of 12, somewhere before he went to be baptized, his father, his adopted father, Joseph, died. Now, there's no doubt about that. And when Joseph died, the elder son would step into the place of leadership in that family, and Jesus did that. And he would have been responsible for the rearing of his half-siblings. I think it was probably Jesus who apprenticed his brothers as stonemasons. He had been apprenticed as a stonemason by Joseph, and now Jesus would have taught that family trade to his brothers. He probably oversaw the wedding of his half-siblings, his half-sisters, and so on. Jesus is very clearly the head of this family, and he never gives it up. It's so fascinating that when, for reasons of strategy, given his public ministry, he's raised in Nazareth, and he lives there for 30 years, but Nazareth is not a good place from which to conduct an itinerant ministry, so he moves to Capernaum, which is where all the roads meet, but he takes his family with him. That's a big deal in that age, to leave your home village and move somewhere. Jesus takes his family with him, and that becomes their town. So clearly, and now here's the point, even on the cross, a son's heart is focused on the care of his mother. And I think what's at stake here almost certainly is that Jesus looks down, he sees his mother. Now let me tell you something, and this is 10 parts imagination and one part exegesis, okay? But what we know from history is that the Romans demanded that crucifixion be unspeakably cruel. And part of that was that the victim was hung on a cross high enough that everybody could see it, because it had to be visible. It had to be public. Rome, I tell people all the time that crucifixion was not about executing the seditionist. It was about putting down the sedition. So it was this extended, cruel, barbaric object lesson. And part of it was that the victim was to be suspended high enough that he could be seen over everybody's heads, but on the other hand, low enough that the dogs could nibble. And of course, the birds would peck. And that was part of the terror and the ignominy and so on of the experience. But the Romans would often, and we know this, the Romans would often look the other way if some friend or even passersby, just out of some measure of to save the poor wretch from that last degree of suffering and so on, wanted to stand there at the foot of the cross and with a swish and chase away the birds and keep away the dogs. All right. I wonder if that's not the duty that Mary has taken to herself. And Jesus looks down, and most dramatically, he sees that his own brothers are not there. Folks, that is, and I think his son's heart is gripped. He knows that there is spiritual suffering, challenges on the horizon, and Mary needs, and so a son's heart, out of concern for his mother, sees John and turns Mary over to John. Now, what's really compelling about that is this, that we know the rest of the story. We know that after the resurrection, 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus is going to appear to his half-brother James. James is evidently going to become a believer because he's the leader of the church in Jerusalem and writes a book in the New Testament. So does another half-brother, Jude. So we know his brothers came to faith. I would argue that Jesus, because the Spirit of God did not enable him to know that on the cross, that Jesus died with the heaviness that his own brothers. You think Jesus loved his family any less than you love your family? Jesus had plowed into his brothers. But as he hung there, his heart was heavy with the reality that his own brothers had rejected him. That's why he turned him over. That's why he turned Mary over to John. And I always think, do you have loved ones who are lost? Is your heart heavy for those loved ones? What does it mean that Jesus knows that personally? Jesus has been there. But now, at noon, the sky grows dark. And for 3 hours, Jesus hangs there in silence. Now, what's going on here? And it's given most important and definitional expression when at the end of those 3 hours, Jesus, citing Psalm 22:1, cries out, my God, not Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And forgive me for repeating myself, but I said yesterday that when we think of death, we think immediately of physical death, the separation of the soul, spirit from the body. It's an important issue to be sure, and the more important as you get older, but the fact is that God can fix physical death so easily, it's kind of an afterthought. In the Bible, death is about alienation from God. When Adam, the first time we encounter death, Adam, don't eat that fruit. The day you do, you'll die. But he died 930 years later physically, but on the moment he ate it, having known what it was to walk in the cool of the day, the moment he ate it, he was alienated from God. And that's what spiritual death is. That's what makes hell to be hell, folks. I'm telling you, I believe in a hot hell, but what makes hell awful is to live with the realization that you'll never, ever be rightly related. You'll always be alienated, forsaken, judicially forsaken by the God who crafted you and made you to know him and enjoy him. He crafted you in such a way that there can never, ever be in this life or the next any measure of soul contentment apart from a right relationship with him. Well, here you have the Father and the Son. And we don't understand the dynamics of Trinitarianism. We know that there is one God and three persons, but it certainly teaches us that there is a measure of bottomless, infinite, beautiful, eternal love and relationship and oneness between the persons of the triune Godhead. And there on the cross for those dark, dark, unspeakably dark hours, the Father forsook the Son. And it was in that, the suffering was done on the cross, and it was there that this is what terrified Jesus as he contemplated it, to be forsaken by the Father. And let me say, I believe it was just as painful for the Father as it was for the Son. But for those 3 hours, Jesus, forsaken by the Father, having been made sin for us, suffering a level of despair and agony that I think we will contemplate for eternity and never fully understand. But for those 3 hours, Jesus is forsaken by the Father. And at the end of those 3 hours, he cries out, this is the fourth of those statements, he cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, I didn't say this last hour, and I'm not going to develop it. But I told you earlier that Jesus was absolutely dependent upon the spiritual resources that God provides us. And one of them is the scriptures. And I believe very possibly there is a certain scripture which was the contemplation of our Savior as he hung on the cross. And that's Psalm 22. Because I've read in several places that it was and even is the habit of Jewish students and rabbis and so on, when they contemplate scripture, they've memorized it and they're going to contemplate a passage, they will say the first and last sentence out loud. And the first sentence is Psalm 22, is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And I picture Jesus hanging on the cross and chanting to himself that psalm. Read it. Go home. Read it. Imagine it in that context. But the psalm is strange because in verse 21 of the psalm, it changes all of a sudden. And a psalm of absolute despair and aloneness becomes a psalm of victory. We quoted from it this morning. Well, go to John 19, because in John 19, you have the next saying, and this is where I want us to focus, and then we're done. John 19, Jesus, the Bible says that John 19 and verse 28 says this. Now again, get the picture. The sky is still mystically, frighteningly dark. And the sun is shining full. This is not an eclipse. This is a supernatural darkness. And I say this, I don't know exactly how God affected it, but it's like there's a curtain drawn across this. But Jesus has cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And now a little time goes by, and it says, verse 28, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Now I find a parallel between that and Psalm 22, 21. You check it out yourself. But the point is that Jesus has something else to say. But one of the realities of crucifixion, there's absolutely no question about this, is that it absolutely drains the body of every, not just by reason of being in a hot sun, but because of the horrible extremities, the physical extremities, every bone, every joint out of place and so on, and your body just saps up every little ounce of energy it has trying to address all of these physical issues and so on. So your body just, and by the way, on the cross, you can't fall asleep because very quickly your rib cage settles in on your breathing apparatus, so you have to hoist yourself up. Many men would die of asphyxia. They would gag to death or pass out, and then they would die because they didn't breathe. But in many cases, because the moisture was sapped out of your body, and your throat would swell and your tongue would swell, and they'd actually gag to death because they couldn't draw air anymore because of the swollen. Well, I think that's what's here. Because the fact is that Jesus has something he wants to say. And the whole moral universe has waited for thousands of years to hear him say it. And he's paid a price that we will explore for eternity to earn the right to say it. And he longs to say it. But his body is so racked with pain and drained of all moisture, and his tongue is so swollen, and his mouth is so, his whole throat box is so dry and chapped and broken, they didn't have the strength to say it. And so I think, rather than being a saying on the cross, I think Jesus gathers all his strength, and in a voice that only those at the foot of the cross could even hear, he croaked out the words, I thirst. And some soldier takes a sponge and soaks some cheap soldier's wine in it, and I lifts it up, and I picture Jesus taking a couple of minutes and trying to get some life back into his throat and his voice box. Just trying to find some strength because he has something to say. And he longs to say it. And he finally gathers the strength. I can never walk past this. And he says, it is finished. It's finished. The books are balanced. The price is paid. It's finished. When you contemplate Psalm 22, remember they would say aloud the first and the last. And Psalm 22 concludes with an exultation that says something like that, this, you have done it. You can translate that, it is finished. Folks, what could break the heart of God more thoroughly than for you and me to think there is something we have to add to that? It's finished. Now Jesus goes on and he says one more time, he speaks one more time, and it's no longer my God, it's Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Now let me just tell you this very quickly. There are three times in the Gospel of John where Jesus speaks of being lifted up. It's always from his lips. In John 3, he says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Then in John 8, in a very interesting passage, he's arguing, this is the Feast of Tabernacles, 6 months before he dies, he's arguing with the Pharisees, and the Pharisees are insisting that he's an imposter, he's not speaking for God, and Jesus says this, when I am lifted up, then you will know that I'm speaking for the Father. And then blessedly enough, in John chapter 12, on Tuesday afternoon of the Passion Week, Jesus says this, I, if I am lifted up, will draw all men to myself. Now, what does he mean by lifted up? There may be more, but at least there in John 8 and John 12, I think, we can know, because the next verse, John says this. So Jesus says, verse 31, I, if I am lifted up, will draw men to myself. And then Jesus says, no, I'm sorry, then John the apostle, in writing the book, says, this spake Jesus concerning the type, the tupos, the type of death. He must die. And then, fascinating enough, in John 18, when Jesus is brought by the high priest Caiaphas to Pilate at 4:30 in the morning, and Caiaphas says, you know we can't put him to death, because Pilate says, you go try him. He says, no, we can't put him to death. And John says this. This was done in fulfillment of what Jesus said concerning the type of death. He would die. So what did he mean by being lifted up? He meant crucifixion. And he contrived, you can trace it, Jesus contrived to make sure, because we might have thought that he would die by stoning at the hands of the Jews. They tried a couple of times, but Jesus contrived to make sure he would die by crucifixion at the hands of the Romans. Why? Well, I said last hour, I think I can demonstrate to you that the Roman government were very, very fastidious about crucifixion, because crucifixion was about not so much executing the seditionists, it certainly had to get that done, but it was about putting down the sedition. And so they demanded that, number one, it be cruel, and we talked about it before, it's unspeakably cruel. You know, it's really staggering that we have embraced, since the 4th century, the cross as the symbol. You know, I always think, and this is kind of a macabre thought, forgive me here, you can erase it if you want, but imagine that you, just, I'm making this up, you meet a young lady, comely young lady, and you're talking with her, and you notice she's got a little bracelet, a little necklace on with charm, and then when you look, you notice that it's a guillotine. Now, you'd think that's a bit macabre, wouldn't you, to decorate your, with a guillotine? Well, here's the curious thing. The guillotine, however you want to pronounce that, was deliberately developed to be swift and merciful. The cross was designed to be lingering and brutally, unspeakably cruel. And it was. And Rome demanded it. Because, again, they were not just interested in getting the seditionists dead. They wanted every onlooker to think, I don't want that to happen to me. Had to be cruel. It had to be lingering. They wanted them at least a whole day on the cross. It had to be public, always outside a main gate, because a main gate is a choke point. You can't go around. And I always say you might squeeze way over to the yonder wall and maybe take your children and wrap their ears in the folds of your garment and scurry past. And you're going to have to witness that poor wretch hanging there moaning and crying. And it's just unspeakable. So, but there's one more point. Had to be cruel, had to be public, had to be lingering. And above all things, it had to be publicly certifiable. That is, Rome would not tolerate the possibility that the word would get out, just the rumor that somehow this seditionist had survived the experience, so the sedition can go on. And so Rome absolutely demanded that before a man who was, now let me just say, Jesus was not crucified having been convicted of sedition. He'd been exculpated of sedition again and again and again in many different ways. But he did, in fact, die the death which Rome had designed for seditionists. And so everybody, the point is this is the blood and the water. Before the man was taken down off the cross, there had to be physical evidence of his death, and there was a protocol that if he was taken down off the cross inadvertently, carelessly, and died, it was just the last hint of life on the ground, and then he died on the ground, every Roman soldier assigned to that detail was immediately put in a cross. Now, that's how serious Rome was. And you didn't have to be there that afternoon, folks, to see the blood and the water. All you had to know is that he died on a Roman cross. And you knew, beyond any shadow of a doubt, he didn't come down till he was a dead person. Now, you see, stoning could be botched. Acts 14, they stoned Paul outside of Lystra. He got up, went into town. We're saying, what in the world went on there, for heaven's sakes? Were they just bad aims? What's going on there? We don't know. But I'm telling you, crucifixion could not be botched. Why is that important? If I be lifted up, if I die by crucifixion, the whole world will know beyond any shadow of a doubt that I died, that I physically died on that cross, and therefore, when Jesus shows himself alive 30 days by many infallible proofs in the face of thousands and thousands of witnesses, there's absolutely no doubt that God has proven true everything Jesus said concerning who he was. He made the most bodacious claim a man could possibly make. He claimed not only to be the Messiah, but he claimed to be God come in the flesh. John 19:7, the Jewish leaders said to Pilate, after Pilate had the fifth time insisted, I'm not going to crucify him as a seditionist, they said, well, if you won't crucify him as a seditionist, he ought to die by our law because he made himself the Son of God. That's why Jesus went to the cross. Romans 1, verse 4, I love the verse. Paul says that Jesus was declared, and he uses the word horizo. It's our word horizon, and I like to picture it that way. Jesus, the announcement was made, the declaration was made in such a way that it was spread across the horizon from earth to sky, from east to west, in such a way that nobody in the world can deny this truth. He was declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. And the reality of the resurrection is a function of the reality of his death. And therefore, when I'm lifted up, you'll know that I'm speaking for the Father. How does God prove true a man's claim to be a divine messenger? Miracle. What's the greatest miracle in all of human history? Jesus comes back from the dead after 3 days in a tomb. That was God's way to absolutely prove true everything Jesus ever claimed about who he was or what he had come to do. Amen and amen. Amen. Jesus has risen. Kevin, why don't you come?
This has been a wonderful explanation of Scripture. And I would be remiss if I did not invite you this morning to take a moment to look into your own heart and life and determine your relationship to Jesus Christ. The proof was there. Jesus Christ came forth from the grave, showing forth that he conquered death and the penalty of sin. Maybe you're here this morning and you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here and you would honestly say, deep in your heart, that you're not certain of where you'll spend your eternity. There's a couple reasons, if that's where you find yourself, that you would feel that way. Most notably, you're depending on something other than Jesus Christ. Your faith is perhaps in your own good works. Perhaps you hope that someday your life will carry you into the kingdom of God. But the Bible is very clear that there is only one way to heaven, and that is Jesus Christ and in him alone. And so faith needs to be in Jesus Christ alone. And with that faith comes assurance, the assurance of our salvation, the knowledge that we will spend eternity with him in heaven. I wonder this morning if you're here and you're not certain, but God is working in your heart this morning, if you would say, Pastor Kevin, pray for me. I recognize a need in my life. Maybe you're not at the point that you're ready to say, I'm ready to place my faith in Christ, but maybe you just say, I know that there's a need there. Maybe you are ready to place your faith in Christ. If God is working in your heart this morning and I can pray for you, I'd love to do that. if you just slip up your hand this morning, that I might pray for you, I'd be willing to do that. Is there anyone? Say, God is at work in my heart and life. Thank you. Thank you. Father in heaven, we just thank you and praise you for who you are. Loving us so much that you would send Jesus to this world to die that death and then show forth your power over sin, its consequence, and offer to us, Lord, eternity with you in heaven. How we thank you and praise you, Father, for the work that you have brought about through your Son, Jesus Christ. The mystery is amazing, and the truth so real. How we thank you. Bless these, Father, who've asked for prayer this morning. Whatever point you're working in their heart and life, we're pleased to see that. And I lift them up in prayer that they might be able to come to a conclusion that they know you as their Lord and Savior and are assured that they will spend eternity with you in heaven. So, Father, continue to work in our hearts as we go from this place. May we strive to know you better and honor you with the way in which we live our lives. Bless Dr. Bookman, Lord, as he departs and heads back to his home. Father, may you give him safety and strengthen his body for all that he's been teaching us, Lord, is tiring, I'm sure. And I pray, Father, that you'd bless him mightily. Again, we thank you, and we look forward to a week in which we can bring you glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Dr. Bookman, thank you. For those who would like more of this opportunity to learn and so forth, we will have the sessions on YouTube available soon, and so you can check that out. You can also fill out a request for CDs and so forth in the library if you'd like to do that. But God bless you, and God bless Dr. Bookman. Thank you so much for being with us here. You're dismissed.